Dr. Gitanshah Sachdev. Now, she is being young, but she's a very talented academician and a very gifted surgeon. And at this young age, she's been able to, demonstrate excellent life surgery that I've been able to see a few times and has so many publications. She's academic in charge and consultant at the Eye Foundation, Coimbatore. And she's going to speak on a very different, difficult subject today. And that is something which everybody would be scared of, whether they are doing SICS or phaco or femto. That's posterior polar cataracts. And I think, as we've gone along with femto, many of us have found that posterior polar cataracts have become our preferred way of operating. So I'll invite Dr. Gitanshah to please go ahead and share her screen and tell us how she why she prefers femto for posterior polar cataracts. For
Thank you so very much, sir, for this very kind introduction. At the outset, I'd like to thank the organizing committee for this opportunity. Is my screen visible?
Yes, please go ahead.
So today my topic would be flags in posterior polar cataracts. I have no financial disclosure. Now we're all aware that the posterior polar cataract has an increased propensity for an intraoperative posterior capsular dehiscence, which makes it a challenging case to handle. Maintaining a closed, stable system and low fluidics are important principles that one needs to keep in mind. However, the femto platform has a distinct advantage over the conventional phacoemulsification in certain steps, such as giving us a perfect rexis and the femto delineation, which negates the need for further hydrodelineation or nuclear fractus. Now, having a central perfect rexis is important because you need an adequate sulcus in the eventuality of a posterior capsule dehiscence. Again, as has been alluded to earlier, the rexis can be customized, and some surgeons prefer an oval shape, which gives you more space for maneuvering the epinuclear plate from the capsular fornices. The next important step would be the hydrodelineation. Now, when we perform it manually, there might be misdirection of fluid with an inadvertent hydrodissection and subsequent capsular blowout. The femto delineation, on the other hand, is exceedingly precise. You get the epinucleus at the exact dimension that you need, and it is uniform throughout. Moreover, the cavitation bubbles that are produced give a certain amount of a pneumodissection, which virtually eliminates the need for a subsequent hydro procedure. The additional advantage of the epinucleus would be that it would give you a shield, which cushions the underlying posterior capsule from all the hydraulic and the mechanical forces during the phacoemulsification process. Now, this femto delineation technique, which Dr. Partha sir had alluded to earlier, was introduced by Dr. Basavara, where you can see that there were three concentric cylindrical patterns. Nuclear softening can additionally be done in cases of associated nuclear sclerosis. So this was described by Dr. Tidiar, wherein along with the cylindrical patterns, he has also broken it into various fragments. So this is a video which demonstrates the fragments that have been formed. You can see that the cleavage plane has already been formed by the femto, because of which the pieces can be removed easily without any manipulation or rotation. The inner core is removed first, and while doing that, these outer layers form a cushion for the posterior capsule underneath. The thick epinuclear plate is then finally removed. One of the advantages that I like best is the inbuilt ASOCT. It is a high definition anterior segment imaging, wherein you can get the integrity of the posterior capsule before actually starting the surgery. Now, this can be done at any stage, be it preoperatively or with the inbuilt femtosecond laser ASOCT or even intraoperatively. Now, a handful of studies have shown the use of a preoperative ASOCT in eyes with posterior polar and conventional phacoemulsification. There were certain limitations, be it either a retrospective study with multiple surgeons or a limited cohort, or in certain cases, PPCs larger than 4 millimeters were excluded. Now, to overcome all of these limitations, we did a prospective single surgeon study, wherein a femtosecond laser platform was used for the posterior polar cataracts of all dimensions with or without association with nuclear sclerosis. So we had a cohort of 50 eyes. Now what was important was that the sensitivity and the negative predictive value was 100%, which essentially means that if you have what looks like an intact capsule on the ASOCT, the risk of an intraoperative PCR was zero. The four eyes that developed the PCR had an opacity which was greater than 4 millimeters. The false positives could essentially be because of an aftershadowing, because of a dense posterior plaque, which may result in the appearance of a non-intact posterior capsule. Now, this is a short video which will just summarize all the points that I've highlighted. You can see a high-definition ASOCT and a discontinuation in the posterior capsule. The epinuclear sheet of 100 microns is made by increasing the posterior offset. Again, you can have predictable capsulotomy. Something has been done in this case with posterior sclerosis. Now, on table, you can see a free-floating capsulotomy. This is subsequently bunched up to the center and is then removed. While doing the FICO, no fluidics are used. You can see that the prefractured lines make it exceedingly easy to separate the pieces and remove it without any excessive manipulation or rotation whatsoever. The softening additionally will drastically reduce your effective FICO time. Now, once the inner layer is removed, you can see that the epinucleus is still forming a good protective shield to the underlying posterior capsule. This is then wheeled out and is removed in toto from the capsular fornices. One should always maintain the principles of closed chamber and insert viscoelastic before removing any instruments. Although coaxial has been used in this case, a bimanual would be preferred in the event of a PCR. A three-piece IOL is then placed in the sulcus, and because of this wonderful capsulotomy, you can have a 360-degree overlap. So I'd just like to conclude by saying that the femtosecond has resulted in an increased safety and a repeatability in the posterior polar cataracts. And the on-screen imaging actually gives you a fair idea as to which eyes will go on to develop an intraoperative capsular rent. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks, Gitansha. And Dr. Mahipal, sir, can you please, because you have a lot of experience with posterior polar cataracts, can you please drive this discussion?
So actually, there's a lot of interest ever since the femto came onto the posterior polar as regards the imaging technology. And just now we are also evaluating whether the pre-op imaging can also help as much as we have the intra-op imaging that of the OCT, because it gives you a three-dimensional image. And it's almost 100% that we have been able to find out whether there is a pre-existing defect or not. And when we are doing this particular procedure, at that time, I'm very, very comfortable in telling my anesthetic whether to give a perivulvar block or not, depending upon whether there is a rent or not. And I can at that particular moment tell. So it is very important for us to even have pre-operative diagnostic modalities of the OCT that are available, whether it's the IUL Master 700 is also giving you a great image. So I think the imaging has really improved the outcomes. And there are several papers, and including in our study, which is not published, that ever since we have been using the femto laser for posterior polar, the incidence of nuclear drop is almost 0%. So I think Titial Abe has also reported this particular thing, that the nucleus drop does not happen because you are very careful and you have visualized the whole thing. So I think that, yeah, Cyrus, you wanted to say something.
Yeah, sir, I have a question. I saw Dr. Titial, sir, doing the surgery. That looks like the Alcon system, which is doing that circular kind of disassembly. Can the Catalyst system do the same thing?
I think it can do. You will have to open it. It's not an open system that where you can do that, but there is nothing stopping that concentric rings. But that concentric rings is in the Lensix system, yes. As of now, it's not as a standard of care in the Catalyst.
What pattern would you prefer in the Catalyst to handle
it? I just prefer a normal pattern as long as I have the epinuclear cushion, so it really does not matter. So what they are trying to say is that these concentric rings is doing a pneumo dissection, which whatever pattern you are following, they will do a pneumo dissection and you won't get a hydro dissection that is there. It's more of a delineation pneumo dissection that happens irrespective of whatever. So you can have six quadrants, you can have with softening, whatever you want. So the only thing is to preserve the epinuclear cushion right till the end. And that is why you don't have a nuclear drop, that even without rotating or by putting any fluid, you would be able to take out all the quadrants of the nucleus that is there. Rohit, you have any comments on how you feel about posterior polars?
I think I have to compliment you for this femtosecond laser. wherein you have that, where you have used the integrated anterior segment OCT to the fullest. And I tell you, we have also started using it since I saw your paper, and we found that it is really worthwhile, where we come to know whether the posterior capsule is intact or not. So with the offsetting of 800 or so, you don't need to have three cylinders. Even a single 800 micron should suffice for that matter. And the best part of the story is you don't need to rotate also. And we end up with a small, the posterior capsular extension is also not that profound. So you can end up with a posterior capsular excess also in such a situation. So I think it has been a good, landmark thing which you have come out with.
Anyone else has any comments?
I think Dr. Grewal also uses, has been preferring this thing, and somehow I don't see him. Grewal sir, before you leave, we want to utilize you to the fullest. I see you do very elegant, posterior rexus with the platform as well, where, managing a primary posterior rexus in congenital cataract. So would love your views on this as well.
I think it was an excellent presentation and it touched on all the important points. As far as the pneumodissection is concerned, pneumodissection depends upon how much cuts you are doing. It also depends a lot on how much hard the cataract is. If you have just bubbles staying within the lines or the nucleotomy, so what I do in these cases, I'll be just making the radial cuts and that's it. I'll not be doing any softening at all in these cases. And I would have a minimum bubbling, set the energy so that there is minimum bubbling. That's it.
Wonderful, sir. And I think, for me also, posterior polar cataracts, I think femto-assisted cataract surgery is my first choice. And before we move on, Dr. Chi, would you like to chip in with any of your pearls, or are you going to tell us in your talk itself?
I'll tell you more in my talk, but I just want to perhaps have this clarified. How do you tell that the posterior capsule is intact on that OCT?
So essentially, there shouldn't be any discontinuation in the posterior capsular line, and the plaque should not be adherent to the underlying posterior capsule. So you'll be able to follow the entire posterior capsule throughout. There should be no areas of adherence, or there should be no skip areas or missing areas wherein it appears dark.
Okay, I mean, I've seen those that have gone beyond that line and yet have not ruptured. And later, when I give my talk, you'll see some interesting cases.
We did find a few false positives as well, because there are sometimes artifacts or the aftershadow itself can give a blackening effect of the posterior capsular underneath. The important point of what we had published was the negative predictive value, which is essentially to say that if the posterior capsule looks intact, there will not be an intraoperative PCR. We did not comment on the fact that if it looks discontinuous, there will definitely be a PCR. So we could have false positives, but the negative predictive value was 100%.
Okay. But just watch my posterior polar videos later. Maybe give you a comment.
Wonderful. We look forward.